Good morning from St George's Church, Wilton, here in Taunton. A very warm welcome to you all. Whether you've been with us often or not been with us for a while, or indeed if this is your first time of joining with us. Whoever you are, wherever you are, and whenever you are watching this, strangers and friends, locals and visitors, believers and doubters, the certain and the curious. It is always a mixed company as Jesus gathers us here and welcomes us. I am the Reverend Jenny Jeffery and for many years was associate priest here, now semi-retired but still retaining a role as chaplain of our church school, Bishop Henderson. In these challenging times, it is good to remember the words of Jesus, "I am with you always." So let us pray. Believing that God made the world, we gather, that it may be reshaped to fulfill God's purposes, we pray, to seek a wisdom deeper than our thinking, we listen. To honour God who gave us voice, we join together in worship.
O church, arise and put your armour on. Hear the call of Christ our captain, for now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies, an army bold whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor.
Hunger for the day.
trusting in God's forgiveness, let us in a moment's silence call to mind our failings. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us then confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or of human origin?" They discussed it amongst themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things." "What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." This is the word of the Lord.
The context of this gospel story is really important. Jesus has just made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, riding in on a donkey and being hailed by the crowds as the Son of David, the fulfillment of their hopes and prophecies and dreams, coming in the name of the Lord to usher in the new world order. Then, immediately after that, according to Matthew, Jesus went into the temple and overturned the tables of the traders, claiming that space back for God. As a result, in verse 14, he continues a ministry of healing, showing that he has authority not just over the crowds and the religious institutions, but authority over nature itself. To prove that fact, in verse 18, he curses a fig tree and causes it to wither. Is it any wonder then, in the light of this frenetic exhibition of power, that we read the opening words of our passage today in verse 23? When he entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus was clearly a threat to the religious and social leaders of the day. He was exhibiting enormous and miraculous powers. The crowds were absolutely enthralled by him. His courage and boldness in confronting the institutions of power was astounding. Of course they would want to question his authority. And the questioning comes out of the security they felt in their own authority, for they were the leaders. The chief priests were in a spiritual lineage that went all the way back to Moses. The scribes were the most learned theologians in Jewish society. And the elders had years of experience and had the unquestioning respect of the people. But Jesus is smarter than all of them and has absolutely no intention in getting engaged in some abstract debate about the nature of his authority in an attempt to prove that his authority is greater than theirs. Instead, he decides to ask them a question that will cause them to struggle as they are caused to reflect on the true nature of authority. In verse 24, Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" Now, this was a tough question for the religious leaders to answer, as Matthew rightly points out to us in verse 26 and 27, because no matter what they said, the answer was bound to upset someone. If they agreed that John the Baptist's ministry came from God, then Jesus would say, "So why don't you listen to him and follow him?" But if they said that his ministry was not from God, then the crowds would have turned on them because they loved John the Baptist. There was no way they could win the argument against a question like that. So as Matthew tells us in verse 27, the best answer they could come up with was, "We simply don't know." So much for their spiritual authority. They were speechless and defenseless in the face of a very simple question from Jesus. And in that moment, the religious leaders were unmasked for who they truly were. They claimed authority and power and privilege over the people. But their chief concern was to protect themselves, their standing in society, and to protect their reputations. They didn't give an answer because they didn't want to lose what they had. All in leadership are called to moments of decision that will have profound impact for the future. Are they, are we, are you prepared to stand up for what is true and right in the eyes of God and to live out ministries by the standards of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Or will they, will we, will you seek to deny the truth in order to protect individual power and position and status? Leadership demands courage to do what is right, often at the expense of personal gain and popularity. Please pray for your leaders. But the leaders that Jesus was addressing were unable to recognize the authority of Jesus, for the simple reason that he was acting out of a form of authority that they had never witnessed before. For them, authority came with a title, with respect in society, with wealth and prestige, with the ability to make decisions that the people would unquestioningly obey, and with the weight of history on their side. But that was not the type of authority that Jesus was modeling to them as the authority of the kingdom of God. The authority of Jesus was of a completely different order altogether. The authority of Jesus was worked out in his welcoming of sinners and prostitutes, in his welcoming of little children and the outcasts and those on the margins. Ultimately, the authority of Jesus was worked out in a life of service, not ruling, a life hallmarked by betrayal and personal sacrifice, rejection, torture, and a criminal's death on the cross. That's where the authority of Jesus lay, not in some sort of power gain that brought with it prestige and wealth and the respect of the people. And those religious leaders had never seen anything like that before and had no idea how to respond to it. At the top of any church's agenda should be the need to consider the church's role in the community, especially now as a result of this current situation, and how the church should have at the heart of its mission, at the heart of its mission action plan, a desire to work towards community transformation. But in the light of this passage, we need to remember that a church that is a leading authority in the community will not be hallmarked by wealth and power and prestige, but will instead be hallmarked by service and welcoming those on the margins and welcoming the little children. It will be a community of sacrifice and vulnerability where those on the margins find a home. That's what authority in the kingdom of God looks like, and that is what a truly Christ-like church must look like. The challenge to us in this passage is the extent to which we are prepared to develop our gifts and position in this community to love and to serve those in need, rather than to seek prestige and honour and respect from others. That's the ultimate value that underpins the work of God's vineyard, as Jesus goes on to outline in the second part of this passage, with the parable he now goes on to give his hearers. Now, this is a very interesting parable and a massive challenge to Jesus, to his first hearers, for a reason that we easily miss, because we are 21st century people living in Britain and we are not first century Palestinians. There is a catch to this parable that is easy to miss. Jesus wants his hearers to make a choice between the sons. Which one has done the right thing and which one has done the wrong thing? The choice is simple. A son who disobeys his father by saying no to him, but then changes his mind. And a son who says yes to his father, but then doesn't go on to do what he said. Which is the better son? To us, probably, the choice is obvious. The better son is the first one, who first says no, but goes on to do the right thing. But that wasn't the obvious choice for his first hearers, because the first son who said no would have brought real shame and embarrassment on his father by disobeying him. Okay, he did go on to do the right thing in the end. But in terms of undermining the social standing of his father in the eyes of the community, the damage had been done in his initial refusal to obey. So in reality, the behavior of the first son was no better than the second son. They were both equally guilty in the eyes of their father. But Jesus wants the religious people to choose between them. They are both equal sinful. But which one is more likely to be redeemed in the eyes of the Father? In the light of that, there is only one choice to make. Redemption and forgiveness is available to the son who at first disobeys and embarrasses his father, but is not available to the son who mocks his father and continues to mock him by his refusal to do what is asked of him. So this isn't a parable about the choices we make, so much as a parable about the need to honour the Father and to give him his due. And the key word in the passage comes in verse 29. But later he changed his mind and went. The phrase changed his mind is not a particularly good translation of the Greek, where another word would be used for that idea. A more literal translation would be to say, later he changed what he cared about and went. And that's the key idea here. When the son said no to his father, all he really cared about was his own comfort, his own way of living. But later, he changed what he cared about and chose instead to care for the honour of his father, and then went out in the vineyard to work for him. At the heart of this passage is a simple question. What do you care about? What do I care about? Are we like the religious leaders to whom Jesus is talking, whose primary care is for social standing and personal reputation and the comforts that come with a lifestyle of privilege? Or is our primary concern going to be for the honour of our Father God, who asked us to go out and work for him in the vineyard of his kingdom? If our primary concern is for the honour of God, we will be called out of our comfort zone and we will need to undertake work for him. But that is what he asks for him and asks of us. And the message of this parable is that if we respond to the call of the Father and change our concern from us to him, then we will be acceptable to him, regardless of what we have done in the past. Many of us may have said no to our Father God in the past, but as soon as we say yes to him, the past is washed away and no longer counts against us in his sight. It doesn't matter what our past contains. All that matters is the yes. And that is why Jesus is then able to say what he does in verse 31. Truly, I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. The religious leaders to whom Jesus was speaking were still locked into their no to God. And so, until they changed their concern, there was no hope of them entering the kingdom of God. But the sinners and those on the margins of society had changed their concern and turned their no into a yes. And so they were perfectly acceptable to God. What about us? Are we too fearful of saying yes to God? Do we think the secrets of our past or the shame of our present life is too much for him? That's not the message in this passage, and that's not the message of the Christian gospel. The past is gone, the present can be healed. All God wants is a yes, so we can let him into our lives, so that we can experience his love and his healing power. Amen.
Chose to bear his heart with sorrow was torn. Loving Lord, we give thanks for the beautiful world that you have created. We thank you for the glorious summer weather that we've enjoyed during these difficult months and that have helped so much to lift our spirits. But Lord, this beauty and wonder is under threat, and we ask you to help us to take very seriously the problems that our world faces because of the way we live, which is fast destroying it. We pray for those who are really trying to bring change, and pray that those who can make a difference will take heed and make the decisions that will save our precious planet. Help us to do what we can do in our own homes. Father, your ways are not always our ways. Help us to be open to your guidance and plan for our lives, even though it's often really difficult to simply say, "Yes, Lord, thy will be done." Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for churches across the country and give you thanks for those who are developing fresh ways of making your name known to the wider community, and for those who are working so hard to make worship possible through online services and the virtual services. We pray that they may be reaching people who are at present more comfortable going online in their own homes rather than stepping into a church. Lord, we are so delighted to have Jenny Jeffery taking our service here today, and very thankful for her renewed health and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we are so grateful that we have got to the point of interviewing candidates for the post of vicar here at St. George's. We place into your hands the whole process of interviews to take place this coming Wednesday and pray for each person involved, particularly our church wardens, Hilary and Peter. May they and those others interviewing hear your voice and be able to come to the right decision. We pray that the person you have in mind comes across well during the interview. It is such a big decision, Lord, for the future of our church, for the coming years, and we long that your will be done to help our church to grow in faith and be the place that you want it to be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for our schools, some of whom are struggling to keep going because a teacher or pupil has gone down with the coronavirus. Thank you for the way in which head teachers have gripped the situation and are doing their very best to help students be able to continue with their education and to catch up with so much that they missed during the past months. We pray for all in authority and for those having to make very difficult decisions in national governments across the world, in local councils, in the health service, and so many other areas of life. We pray that they have the courage to do the right thing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Lord, we pray for and ask you to bless all people who are in trouble and who are afraid today. Those who are tired because they have too much to do. Those who are struggling with finance or are facing the prospect of unemployment. Those who are unhappy because of an unkind word or action. We pray for those who are anxious because someone they know and love is ill or in pain. For anyone we know who has recently been given bad news about their health or the health of a loved one. Lord, help us to know what to say and when to speak. May we always be ready to give practical help whenever we can and to ensure that those on their own are able to manage and cope with their day-to-day lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are lonely because someone they love is not there for them. When death separates us from those we love, and we find it hard to live without them, take from us all bitterness, fear, and resentment, and help us to remember that death has no power at all over the peace you give, and the love we shared with the departed one goes beyond the grave. Father, we give thanks and pray particularly for those whose anniversary of their death falls at this time. Surround those in need with your wisdom, your spirit, your healing and your life-giving peace. Strengthen them with the knowledge that you are always there to lean on and to be carried through these difficult times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, Lord, we'll end with a lovely prayer that St. Augustine wrote, who, after many struggles in his life, said yes to God. Calm us, Lord, as you still the storm. Still us, Lord, and keep us from harm. let the tumult within us cease. Enfold us, Lord, in your peace. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
May God be a bright flame before you, a guiding star above you, a smooth path below you, and a kindly shepherd behind you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, his Son Jesus, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love and pray for, now and always. Amen. Now go from here, surrounded by God's presence, to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Thank you for watching our service. Next Sunday will be our first online Harvest Festival service. So we look forward again to you joining us. Details of the Zoom coffee gathering will be on the screen at the end of this service. Meanwhile, stay safe and stay connected.
Send me out from here, Lord, to serve a world in need. May I know no man by the coat he wears, but the heart that Jesus sees. And may the light of your face shine upon me, Lord. You have filled my heart with the greatest joy. And my cup is overflowing. Go now and carry the news to all creation, every race and tongue. Take no purse with you, take nothing to eat, for he will supply your need.